If you don't go out there and spread the word and know that there are doctors here who can train our doctors to give us the same kind of health care as going abroad, because more than perhaps 70% of the people cannot afford to go anywhere. If Glenn wasn't working where he was working, and myself, and we didn't have our little insurance to cover his bills, what would have been our position? We would not have been able to do anything. You understand? We would not be here today.
Johns Hopkins Medicine has a wonderful legacy and a great history. It actually started late in the 19th century when a very prominent Baltimore businessman, Mr. Johns Hopkins, donated $7 million to begin a medical school and a hospital. His name really was Johns Hopkins. He was given the name of his maternal grandmother as his given name, and Hopkins is the family name that still remains. So, part of the organization to which he left his money is now Johns Hopkins Medicine, where we bring together the healthcare system as well as the School of Medicine. It is that joining that allows us to provide a full range of programs, of educational programs and research to help improve healthcare.
It was in 2006, the then Minister of Finance, who was the Prime Minister, asked me to serve on an executive committee which involved the Johns Hopkins Medicine International.
So we have the genetics, okay? So we have a population that hypertension and diabetes is a part of what we have, in our background. So we know that. But we also have adopted the sedentary lifestyle, etc., and there's a huge impact.
I don't know the actual percentage, but I would guess 80% of cardiac patients in Trinidad simply can't afford private care. So before the government paid for cardiac services in the public sector, a patient who needed valve surgery, for example, either they had the money and they got the surgery, or they didn't have the money and they didn't get the surgery, and that was the end of it. There were no other options. So now there is a public service. We just need more staff because we can't keep up with the workload. But the bulk of the need is in the public sector, and these patients just can't access the private sector.
From a Hopkins perspective, the biggest attraction for us was that it would really be a multi-pronged approach to help meet the objectives. We would be training healthcare providers, nurses, paraprofessionals, and doctors, as well as working directly with patients and their families to help educate them.
I always knew that I wanted to go pursue my master's. I just didn't know where. And so since they had a program here and it was in relation to the TTHSI program, I said, hey, why not? And so I did apply.
The decision was really made that although a full-time program, would be good to have eventually, the most immediate need was for an executive-style program that would be designed in a way that would accommodate working professionals.
Most of my classmates, at least, they're managers, lead technicians, what have you. So they're in positions, leadership positions, and so the program allows them to kind of understand their job better and to improve it and to also change the system step by step.
Glenn's condition did not allow us to have any sort of treatment for him here other than medication. There was no doctor that was available to do any sort of surgery on him, which was a total shock to me.
Baltimore area, which has approximately the same population, has somewhere in the neighborhood of 250 cardiologists.
When I finished internship in 2005, there was only one cardiologist in the public sector.
So the fellowship program we did look at was because we found that we didn't have specialized training in cardiology within the country. So therefore, the development of a fellowship training program was essential because the people who were specialized in cardiology went to America predominantly, but of course they stayed and there was no obligation for them to come back. So therefore, the development of a training program which was tailor-made for the Caribbean and for Trinidad in particular was of paramount importance.
But training here will allow everything to flow seamlessly from training into service, and it'll suit everybody's desires. Just being part of the first ever initiative, I think even for Johns Hopkins, this is the first time they've had a fellowship training program outside of America where they were able to issue certificates to fellows. So just being part of the first group is very exciting.
I was at a meeting in San Fernando General Hospital, the largest hospital, I think, in Trinidad and Tobago, and was walking down the hall and saw sign over a ward, cardiac unit, hadn't been one before. Extremely satisfying to see that the impact has been immediate.
Blood tests before the equipment, this new equipment came in. We used to have to wait like three months, because every 3 months we come to see the doctor to get our result. Sometimes you come, there's the doc, the lab broke down, you didn't get the result also too. You didn't get the blood result, so then you have to take back blood again, then get another result.
Very interestingly, I spoke to a physician who was doing her internal medicine rotation in Miami. I spoke to her over the weekend, and she said that in her clinics in Miami, Jackson Memorial, she would have about 8 to 10 patients per clinic. Now, the fact is some of our clinicians are having to see maybe 30, 40, or even 50 patients in one clinic. That's a 4-hour or 5-hour clinic. Now, it's impossible to deliver a high quality of care with that kind of doctor-patient ratio.
The elements of our program include building professional capacity, improving the delivery of first-class diabetes care, and providing certain special services related to the detection of complications of diabetes.
Most of my role in this job was helping implement Johns Hopkins program and making sure we are offering point of care and explaining the results and supporting not only the patients but other clinicians like the nurses, or making sure the doctor is aware that we've done these tests and this patient needs to be seen, and making sure the patient is seen in a shorter base of time than for them to return in 3 months, which is normally the case.
When I joined the TTHSI program, Nancy Ellen trained me to use the machines that we use, the DCA Advantage machine and the Cholestec machine, to test cholesterol. We went through step-by-step process of taking the patient's blood, using the cartridges, analyzing the data, and interpreting the data to the patient.
Now it's that they have the new machine, we get the result right away. The people who are working right now is educating you more about how to change your lifestyle.
We've always, maybe for the last 20 years, we have known that we've had a major problem with diabetes. But I think with the outreach program, the profile of diabetes and diabetes care has been raised. And I think patients are becoming more aware of the need to look after themselves.
At Johns Hopkins, we're very proud to have been an important part of the Trinidad and Tobago Health Sciences Initiative.
I would like to say that it's been an excellent collaboration. I personally feel that what I loved about it, people might have grumbled a bit, say, oh, why are you bringing in a foreign entity? But nobody had ever taken on in the past that education. Nobody had the time to take on the education, a fellowship program. We couldn't do it, they said. Why hadn't it been done? Everybody's busy with their practice, doing this, doing that. You came in as educators and you did the job.
Johns Hopkins has been fantastic, and my only regret is that they couldn't be here a little bit longer. I think if they had another 2 years and could train another 5 or even more cardiologists, it would have been that much better.